Diolch am ymuno ni yng Nghynadledd Cenedlaethol Seren 2018. Ewch yn bellach. Thank you for joining us in the Seren National Conference 2018, Above and Beyond. Dyma sesiwn. This is session Mathemateg a Mathemateg Bellach. Maths and Further Maths.
Welcome to this session. My name is Sofia Lajkova. I'm a mathematician and I work in Swansea University. As part of my job, I work with students like you from year 9, year 10 onwards, and I try to expose them to more mathematics. So this session is actually about doing math and more math. I also work for Further Math Support Program, which aims to increase the number of students like you who are able, capable, hardworking in mathematics to take extra qualification at A level. So first of all, I want to see your hands if you're already taking further mathematics. Okay, almost everybody. The session is not about further math as such. And if you don't do further math, don't worry, because we're just gonna do more math. So before I explain what the aim of the session and what we're gonna be doing exactly, as you're fresh, still fresh in the morning, we're gonna do math. So that's the first question. I do not want you to talk to anyone. It's really talking to yourself. So for 5 minutes, I don't want you to talk to anyone. Just think and do whatever you can. You need something to write on. It's a warm-up question, but it's reasonably smart. So you will need to write and think. So 5 minutes and no talking. I will give you a hint at some point. Sorry? Well, you need to do a little bit more before you go to that point. Okay, if I ask you to move further down. If you don't know how to approach the question, all you have to do is forget about it and just try to derive as much information as possible from what you see. It's like being a detective. What can you tell about X from what you already know? So my first hint is here. One of the numbers you actually know, it's one. I hope you worked it out. Yeah. Secondly, in order means that we've got these inequalities. But it also means that we can compare any of those in order. I'm just randomly writing this. So for example, that would mean that x is actually less than, say, x to the power 4. Or x is less than x to the power 0. So this is my first hint. Continue working now. My second hint is here. So you should work out that that holds. Yeah, can I see a note from you if you've done that? Yeah, because x to the power naught is actually 1, so that works. You should be able to work that. Can I see a note from you if you can see this? Yeah, some of you. This is your next step. And after that, it becomes easier. So a few more minutes for you to work it out. How do you get that symmetry? X squared. Okay, so we can stop now. Anybody has got an answer? You think you know where that number is? No. Okay, so we'll work it out. Second one. Is anyone brave enough to tell us where did the second one come from? I've seen some notes, so obviously you've done it. And I've seen some good writing. No one is brave enough. Right, okay. So if you compare x squared, and we know that x squared is less than 1, am I right? Yeah, that immediately tells you that your x is going to be between minus 1 and 1. Yeah, can we see that? Yeah, okay, excellent. The next one I'm going to look at is x cube, x to the power cube. Well, actually, x is less than x cube. If you don't know what x is, you cannot divide, because we don't know whether it's positive or negative. What do we do if we don't want to divide? What do you do when you rearrange equations, when you solve them? There is a magic word. You probably do know it. Factorize. Yeah? Does it make sense? Yeah? Okay. So I'm going to move it to the left. X minus x cubed is less than 1. So my factors are 1 minus x squared. 1 minus x squared, x less than 1. Less than 0. Less than 0. Yeah. What do I know about this one? Is it positive or negative? Are you shy because we are being filmed? My yesterday group was so loud and shouty. So, okay, do shout me something. Can you just whisper? Do you think it's positive or negative? Whisper. Positive or negative? It is positive because x is between minus 1 and 1. Yeah, so that's positive. Which tells us that x is negative. The only way product of two factors is negative, one of them should be negative, one positive. So x is less than 0. What do we know? If we combine the two, that it gives us even more information. So we know that x is equal, actually in between minus 1 and naught. Yeah? Few other things you need to do. You put the answer on the spot. So, for example, and some of us have done it. Minus x to the power minus 1 is minus 1 obviously tells us it's going to go into the denominator. And so it looks like that. My x is negative. So I'm just going to put minus with x. So it's actually here. So now 30 seconds for you to work it out. Where is that number on that line? Where is it? Possibly you can just pick up a number between minus 1 and 0 and see what happens. Any answers? Yeah? Yeah, it's supposed to write. So it's obviously, from this, it follows straight away that we know that that is going to be greater than 1. Yeah, well done. Can I see a note from you if you've got that and you think you're confident? Yeah, okay. Excellent. So more about things that you might meet when you apply to university. Further mathematics is a popular qualification now, and I see more and more students who are like you, they're doing further math, and it didn't come for free. In 2010, the Welsh government set up further math support program, and you can see from that point the number of students who take further math is going up. So be very grateful to your school that you can take it in your school. And some students actually cannot do that, so they take it through further math support programs that I work for. And those students are studying further math online. I may have a couple who are doing it through FMSP. Is anyone here who does it online with us? Yeah, okay, which school are you? Okay, yeah, excellent. So if you're not doing further math and you want to know how it is, if you do it through the program, you can ask that gentleman. But it's very good if you do further math and you're kind of smart and you know that you're going to go to good university. However, 80%, this is anecdotal, but I was told it by a person who actually works for Cambridge, that 80% of students who are studying in Cambridge for any degree, they've got a full A level in mathematics, which tells you that if you're looking for a STEM degree, you definitely need to do further math. To distinguish further, some universities introduced extra qualifications, extra exams or tests. STEP is one of the exams. It's very tough. There are three papers, 1, 2, 3. One is the easiest, 3 is the hardest. If you're going to apply to study mathematics in Cambridge, you will be asked to sit the hardest paper. Step one you can do, still you would need to do that if you, for example, go into Warwick or Bristol or Bath, other good universities. An alternative to that is AA, just one paper. In my opinion, it's easier. Some students say this is more difficult than Step. MAT is a test, it's not an exam. That test is unusual because you take it in year 13 in November, Mathematics Aptitude Test. And some of the questions I'm going to show you today are from MIT and also from STEP. It's very good if you're targeting good degree and good university, and obviously your math teachers and people like me who work at universities and do research in mathematics, we want you to do well and to go to a good university. But the reason is we are promoting those is slightly different. These papers are superb, and questions like this are very, very good. and they're true to the nature of the subject. So for us, it's not about you going to a superb university as such, although you will be. For us, it's just doing more mathematics. You can see the list of degrees, and there are two universities, but there are more universities. For example, Warwick, if you would like to study mathematics, and if you take MIT for Oxford, they would give you a lower offer. Some other universities, not from the Russell Group, would also give you a lower offer if you take further mathematics. What do you do as part of MIT test? Nothing is particularly surprising. 2.5 hours, that's okay. Mid-October in year 13, well, actually in November in year 13, but no calculators, no formula, nothing. You just come there with your brain and your head on and you do it. These are the topics that you do. Combinatorics is, you don't do much of it as part of mathematics, but you may do as part of computer science. And also you would need those questions if you apply to study philosophy or computer science or computer science with philosophy. I don't think this look surprising. This perhaps they look all right. Some of the questions do not require the knowledge of A level. They are GCC questions. Like one we did. There is nothing smart about it. You would be able to do it in your year 9 if you've got the right tools and if you've practiced. So I've got a few topics that I picked up because I think they are they a little bit to learn from. And this is my second question. The result is well known. You probably know it at GCC, am I right? Yeah, the result is familiar. The question is how to prove it. On all those papers and those tests, and actually it's part of your Oxbridge interview, you may be asked to solve that question like that on the spot. It's not enough to know that it's true. It's actually what you're asked to do. You're asked to justify. So what facts would you use to actually prove that? One hint I'm going to give you straight away. You may need to introduce X notations. This is probably not enough. You also may need to draw extra things. What we've got is a circle and you've got quadrilateral. We don't like them as such, it's not regular. What you do like to have is a simple figure, which is a triangle. So 4 minutes for you to try and do that. I'm going to give you a few hints as we go along. I'll give you time for discussion, so I really want you not to talk to each other, please. You may need an extra radius, which will give you 2 triangles straight away. That's my first hint. And if you've got a triangle, you want to have a good one. Good one means something that you can tell about. An isosceles triangle is a good one. So your extra line goes here. Yeah. That's another radius. Can we see two isosceles triangles? Yeah. Okay. So this side is exactly the same as. Struggle with my tablet here for some reason. It doesn't calibrate. So that's another side. That's another side. What kind of angle do you have here, for example? Don't know whether you can see that you cannot say that it's half of y. Can we see that? It's not half of y. Yeah, you wouldn't be able to prove that. So you probably want to introduce a notation. So I would call this alpha and that beta. I like Greek letters. You can have whatever you like. And so then what do we need to prove? If my y is equal alpha plus beta, what would I want to prove? What do I want x to be? Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely, alpha plus beta or 2 alpha plus 2 beta. Yeah. What facts can I use? I obviously should use the fact that both triangles are isosceles. Where do they meet x? They meet x around point 0. And what do we know about all these angles? Absolutely. So you're almost there. So 1 minute for you to finish it off. As soon as you can see how you link what you need to find, you're on the right way. So in the left triangle, we can see that that's beta. Yeah. And that's alpha. So what about this angle here? Anybody can tell me how much is that in terms of alpha? Yeah, well done, 180 minus 2 alpha. Similarly, the other one will be 180 minus 2 beta. Yeah, if I add them together around point x, x plus 180 degrees minus 2 alpha plus 180 minus 2 beta is equal 360. So get rid of that. I know you're not allowed to do that in school. You're supposed to move them to the other side, but it's okay. So x will be equal to 2 alpha plus 2 beta. Yeah, and you've proved what you needed to prove. So what is difficult about it? There is nothing particularly hard. The problem you've got here is that in comparison with those tests, what you do at school doesn't prepare you for an argument like this. But it's actually a GCSE question. So there is. So in geometry questions, a good diagram would do. You would need to do extra, introduce extra things. Try to do geometry without algebra. It's actually very tough. Euclidean geometry that you study at school was developed by famous mathematician Euclid without knowing algebra. So every single fact he had to prove using shapes and measure rather than using algebra. Algebra makes it easier. So you've got that for free now. Introduce a new notation, see what happens. Obviously, justifications matter. You're not going to go anywhere. You will not get any marks in step if you do not justify. Every single step should be justified. So that's my... Okay, question number 3, I want you to do in your head. So that's a quick question that should just click. There's nothing to write. There's nothing to calculate. There's nothing smart about it. It should click. So let's see if it clicks. And if you've got your answer, can I see your hands? Okay. Yeah. As soon as you've got your answer, I want to see your hand. Okay. Could you tell us what is the answer, first of all? Yeah. 200. Yeah, how did you get there? Mm-hmm. 10 squared, yeah. Oh, okay, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, you may not want to sort of to have the square root, so a squared plus b squared equals 10 squared, yeah. And similarly, d squared plus c squared equals 10 squared, and you add them together. Okay, if you see that in exam, you wouldn't get any marks from me. Actually, the answer is correct. What is missing? How do you justify using Pythagoras? By what? So to use Pythagoras, you need one right angle, am I right? Yeah, okay, what fact does tell you that those two angles are 90 degrees? Your intuition was obviously right. How do you know that, yeah?
It goes through the midpoint of the circle. Wait,
I think I know what you mean, but it doesn't sound right. Anybody else, yeah? Okay, yeah. There's another fact that actually each of those angles stands on a diameter. Yeah, okay. So that would do. With those justifications, you're going to get your full mark. Without it, it just goes to the bin. I don't want to scare you. I want to inspire you. So, okay, that's a proper question from MIT. It's a multiple choice. So this is what you're given. Yeah. And you need to decide whether your angles alpha, beta, gamma are related by one of those. So 5 minutes for you to try and do that. There's nothing smart about it. Nothing smart. It looks quite a difficult question to do. It's actually quite easy. The answers suggest the method. You've got a triangle there already. You probably need another one. The second one will have 90 degrees in it. It makes it easier, but it's not essential. But the first one, we would be able to say, and it doesn't look like it has got 90 degrees angle. So what rule can we use in that triangle that would actually lead you somewhere there? Pythagoras theorem is very good, but if you don't have a Pythagoras, we've got sine and cosine rule. And that sine cosine rule is true for any triangle, so we're just going to look for familiar facts. Okay, I'm seeing some good stuff, so I think you're on the right track. You want to have two triangles because you want to, in one triangle, in the one you've got, you can obviously link gamma and beta straight away. You may need to introduce more notations, but you will link those two angles. You need a second triangle to bring alpha into it. Let's see if my pen writes here. Yeah. Okay, so your second triangle is here. You will not need to justify why this is 90 degrees. And I trust you know why that. Because it's tangent. Yeah, it's a tangent. to the radius. So it's 90 degrees, but you will have to say it. You've got two sides which are equal to the radius. I haven't seen any of you writing that, but that makes it easier. Yeah. So if you use, for example, sine rule you use with two angles, two sides. So if you want to link in this triangle, you want to link these two, you probably need this side here, and I'm going to give it a notation. So now, anyone is brave enough to tell me how the sine rule would look like for this triangle? If you're not brave enough, I'm going to pick up someone. Okay, I'm going to start. So, MC divided by the sine of the opposite angle, yeah, gamma, is equal to, anyone can continue? Yeah, excellent. So in my last session, I almost got a single answer from a girl. Now it's all so far, it's everybody was a boy. I really like girls to shout out. Okay, in the second one, so that's enough. That's a good one. Yeah. Why do I like MC here? It's obviously a little bit, it does look like something that I would need to get rid of. However, MC is a common side for the other triangle. So that would work. Yeah, can we see that? Now, I want you to write a similar statement for linking alpha and MC. For MC, the opposite angle is 90 degrees, and for alpha, the opposite side is R. Okay, I've seen some right answers, so I'm just going to write it. So from this triangle, MC, the opposite angle is 90 degrees, which is actually 1, but I'm going to start with just writing it properly. And R divided by sine alpha. Yeah. Okay, so this is 1, so M is equal to R over sine alpha. Sine alpha. Sorry, not M, MC. MC. So what I can do now is I can plug it into my first equation, yeah, and I want, that would help me to get rid of MC, then I want to get rid of R. So half a minute for you to work out which of those answers is actually correct. So now you've got everything you need. Which of those answers is the right one? If you use R over sine alpha to substitute to the first one instead of MC, yeah, you want to get rid of fractions, so multiply across. You don't know what R is, but you do know it's not zero, so you can divide by it. If you want to get rid of it. So let's see what happens here. So if I substitute R over sinusine alpha, I over sine alpha into the first one, sine gamma equals R over sine beta. Yeah, I do not want to have fraction. And so I multiply across. So it's going to be R sine beta divided by sine alpha, sine alpha, yeah, equals R sine gamma. Yeah, just multiply across. Still don't want that. I don't want the denominator, so I multiply by sine alpha. R sine beta equals R sine gamma times sine alpha. And if I divide by R, just going to do that. If I divide by R, I'm going to have the second one straight away. Yeah, okay. So the questions are unusual, but they're not so difficult. You may want to practice as many as you can. If you've got a friend to discuss it with, it works better. And any mathematics teacher would be able to help you with those little things. Okay, enough of geometry. We're going to do a little bit of algebra. In the first one, we can do just the first one. What is the value of 101 to the power 2 minus 1 squared? And I don't want you to use a calculator. And ideally, you don't have to write anything. So what is the way to work out any of those without writing much or without calculating, without multiplying those big daunting numbers? Almost not. You've got a difference of two squares. And for the difference of two squares, you've got a beautiful formula. Do we remember that? A minus B squared is equal to two factors. Yeah, can anybody shout what those are? Yeah, excellent. A minus B, A plus B, that's your answer. So if you apply that, you'll get your answer straight away. Can you tell us your answer? 10,200. Yeah, if you got 10,200, you are right. Got 10,200. So this is a question from UK Mathematical Challenge. The answer is really nice. So 5 minutes for you to work it out. The principle is the same. The answer is a nice number. So we are now doing the second question. Here it is, it's one one. But the answer is really nice. And the principle is the same. If you don't do the calculations, if you factorize the numerator in each of those, look at those fractions separately, simplify it using that beautiful formula, it will get easier straight away. So when simplifying, you're going to look at the whole fraction, for example, this one, 102 squared minus 100 squared divided by 102 plus 100. Yeah, keep it as a fraction, factorize the numerator, and you'll see what happens. So at some point, you will see that each of those fractions gives you the same value. Can I see a note from you if you worked it out? Each of those fractions have the same value, okay? But you will be, yeah. So if I factorize the numerator, and why do I not to do any calculations? Because mathematicians are easy. Many formulae do exist just because we are lazy. So we want an easy path. Minus 100, that's fine. 102 plus 100, yeah, divided by 102 plus 100. What do I do next? Say it louder. Absolutely, yeah, we are lazy. We don't want to do any work. We just want to have a nice shortcut. So the answer is 2, yeah? If you're not convinced, try to do the next one and you'll see what happens. Your next step is to work out how many of those 2 do you have. If you've done the second question, the next one is, well, it's called number 10. So in the second question, you should see that each of those fractions is actually 2. Yeah, we divide by 2. And how many of those we've got? It's easy to see. For example, in the first one, you've got, you start with 1 here and you go up to 100. So there are hundreds of those. So it's 2 multiplied by 100. But again, I don't want to multiply, I just want to divide by 2. And so the answer is 100. what I've seen from working with students to prepare them for those tests, things like the difference of two squares should just click. If I wake you up in the middle of the night, that should just work. You should be able to do a question like that straight away. So those would need, by the end of your preparation, those would need require no thinking from you at all. You would just be able, should be able to do that. So that's a formula that whenever you can apply it, you should apply it. So in question 10, you will need to introduce notations. If you didn't have algebra, to indicate that x plus 10 is a square number, you would draw a square. Because we've got algebra, we can easily introduce a notation. Notice that some of you, and in my previous session yesterday, it was exactly the same situation. Some of you would copy your question in your books. Apparently, I do the same. When I copy the question, it gives me time to think slowly, and I think with the speed of writing. So I don't know whether this trick works for everybody, but it does work for me. So if you don't know what to do with the question, copy it, and it gives you a slow pace to think. Then once you've copied it, you can highlight the bits you think are important, you can highlight the bits you need to express further. Okay, some people have got their notations, yeah? So, could you tell me your notations you introduced? Okay, so you wrote that x plus 10 is equal to, yeah. And what about x plus 97? Same thing. Yeah, okay. So this is a good thing to start with. It's not going to work because we don't know that the result are the same. Yeah, can we see that? Yeah. So just, I'm going to do different letter. As soon as you've got a different letter, you're not falling into any conclusions because you wouldn't be able to justify they're the same number, so two numbers. So you've got your extra variables. It's okay, it's fine. And what do you do? Well, actually you want to find x, but sometimes it's a good strategy to eliminate x and see what happens, because you've got now three variables, you've got x, a, and b. I cannot eliminate a and b from there, but I can eliminate x. And as soon as there is no x, there is a relationship between a and b, and this might help, yeah? So my x from the first one, x is equal a squared minus 10. From the second one, x is equal b squared minus 97. Yeah. What should I do next? Yeah. Yeah. So if you don't know what to do, just do whatever mathematics tells you. Not much you can write, but that you can write for sure. Well, the next step is not so trivial. So what we do know that we are looking for integer values. So there are not infinitely many answers to this question. There is a finite set of those answers. And there may be a lot, but you still might be able to distinguish between them. So I'm going to move B to the left-hand side. And I'm going to move 10 to the other side. It's minus 87. I do not like a negative number. I'm just going to swap it. So it's going to be B squared minus A squared is equal to 87. When I look at it with my intuition, I know that I'm happy. I see that and I think, okay, I've done the right thing. Well, this comes with experience of doing these questions. I don't know whether you are happy, but can I see a note from you if you know what to do from this point onwards? I don't see a note, so yeah, okay. So I'll tell you what I think. Well, the only thing I can do is actually factorize it, right? Yeah, we're going to use that magic formula. So instead of the left-hand side, I'm going to write b minus a times b plus a. Can I factorize 87? What factors go into 87? How can I represent as a product of two factors? 29 times 3? Yeah? Does it work? Yeah, it works. So also can be 3 times 29, am I right? There is one extra option. What is another option? Yeah, 87 times 1? There is one more. 1 times 87. So here you are being a detective. You just work out what are the possible combinations, which tells you, for example, that B minus A could be 29 and B plus A should be 3. Yeah? Your second option would give you B minus A equals 3 and B plus A is 29. And you've got two more options. Out of those options, because you're looking for integer factors, you would be able to find A and B. You would need to try different numbers. Yeah? Or actually, if you've got those two, if you add them together, yeah, A disappears and it gives you an answer for B. Yeah, am I right? Yeah. So from this point, you know what to do. We're not going to finish that question. I just wanted you to see how one can apply that here. And the second point is introduce the notations as usual. And one more point is you've got a finite number of cases, so don't be afraid. You'll find the solutions. Okay. This is a quick one, and it's another thing that those students I work with, by the end of the course, I expect that this will just click. So if you think you know what to do, then well done. If you don't know what to do, you'll learn, and you won't forget it after today. You'll just remember it. We're not talking about complex numbers, so they do not come in question. And if you don't know what to do, the other way of approaching something like that is, okay, you've got that equation. Can I find x? So if you know what to do, do what you think you should do. If you don't know what to do, try to find x. Your a is a parameter. Doesn't look very convenient, but there's nothing wrong with it. It would work. So if you know what to do, do what you think should work. If you don't know what to do, try to find x. Maybe difficult to factorize it. The only thing I would say you would need to do, and I've seen you already doing it, is I would move 1 to the other side. Yeah. Then I've got a perfect quadratic equation. So I've got x squared, I've got x, and I've got a free term. It may factorize easy, it may not, but if you're not sure that your equation would factorize nicely, then just use the formula. The formula ax squared plus bx plus c equals naught, when our case a is 1, b is actually a, and c is a minus 1, you know that x, 1, 2 will be equal to minus b plus minus square root b squared minus 4ac divided by 2a. Yeah. So in our case, that would give you minus a plus minus. B is a, so that's a squared minus 4. A is 1, so that's 1. And c is a minus 1 divided by 2. So it's minus a plus minus a squared. Minus 4a plus 4. What is the condition for this thing to be two distinct real roots? Discriminant more than 0. Yeah? Okay. What about this discriminant? What can you tell me? And I hope it clicks. If it clicks, it's very good. If it doesn't click, it would click very soon. So what can I tell about this? This looks quite special. It's actually very nice. What is nice about it? It's a square, am I right? Yeah, okay. Can you tell me what square is it? Can you tell me what square it is? Yeah, a minus 2 squared. Okay, excellent. So, the discriminant cannot be negative. It can be either positive or it actually can be 0. So, what is the condition then? If it's positive, I have two distinct roots. If it's 0, how many roots do I have?
One
repeated. So, I do not want to have that case. Out of all those a's, I'm not happy with a equals 2. Am I right? Yeah, the rest actually fits. So using discriminant is very convenient, and in many cases, you would need to do that. Right, we're not going to do that because we run out of... but I want you to read this question. So I'm going to give you 1 minute to read this question. This is a question from step paper 1. Remember, if you're applying for Cambridge, you're going to be asked to do step 2 and step 3. Step 3 relies on your knowledge of further maths. And when I do those questions, I'm like you. I read it and I think, oh gosh, what am I supposed to do? Then I just talk to myself. And one of those things I find useful, and I like doing, I still do that. I read it before I go to bed. I wake up and I still think about it. I do believe that at night I'm still thinking about that question. It's not that scary. It's a long question, it's not that scary. See that there are two parts. Can you see that? There are two parts of the question. It looks like one thing to do, one problem, but actually it falls into two. And STEP likes doing it. When you do the first part, it's not just doing what you already know. You learn something sometimes. And then you apply it in the second part. There might be a third part. Sometimes they indicate that there are two parts. Sometimes they just give you a long question. But even the design of it tells you there are two parts of it. Yeah. So the first part ends here. What does it ask you to do? So yesterday we spent a long time discussing what do you actually have to do in that question. So this equation, solve the equation. Equation looks simple. Yeah. Those simple things sometimes have very difficult solutions. That's the case. So it looks simple. Somebody writes, okay, x equals a plus b. A is not 0, b is not 0. So a equals a plus b. A is not 0, and b is not 0. So b is not 0. Okay. Show that there are no values of a and b for which this will give you the correct answer. Basically, you are asked to show that is the wrong answer. It doesn't work. Yeah, can you see that? So you're asked to show that that answer from one of the candidates is just a misconception. It's not going to work. How do you show that the answer doesn't work? The next step is simple, yeah? Exactly. To show that something doesn't work, substitute it into it, and you'll get something. We're going to do it. It's very quick. So A plus B equals 1 over A plus 1 over B. What would you do next? Yeah, get rid of denominator. So make it one fraction on the left. It's already so B plus A over AB. Yeah, multiply across AB equals B plus A squared. Well, if you open the brackets and simplify, I'm going to do it just straight away. B squared plus plus AB plus A squared is equal to naught. So it's not so straightforward. There are different ways of showing that it does not have any solutions. But, you know, if you don't know what to do, try to see something which you already know. What do you see familiar in this thing? It has got a quadratic, yeah? So in a way, if you don't know what to do, A is a parameter, but it looks like a quadratic equation. If A was 2, it would look like B squared plus 2B plus 4 equals naught, but it's not the case. So you can treat it as a quadratic with a parameter A. Try to solve it, and you'll see straight away that it doesn't have any solution. Okay, I hope I didn't scare you. It's interesting. You need a company to do that. So one of those leaflets that you've got, can I just borrow this? One of those leaflets that you've got has got different classes for year 12 students that we do across Wales. You're welcome to come. Lots of students come. They do not necessarily have certain students. Everybody who likes math is welcome. We do it in year 12, and we continue helping you to do more math in year 13. And while you are packing up, I'm just going to show you a few things. So one of the other messages that I've got for you, if you're trying to apply to the very best universities, there are several, to do math, consider doing physics as well. It's very good that you do double math, triple math. Triple math is the way to go. Physics teaches you problem solving. Why would you sort of, more math is classes like this one for STEP, MIT, AA, and it does work. This is a quote from one of further math students who went to BUS. Well, math is okay, further math is not that bad. What really taught me to do mathematics is doing problems like this ones. Why study further math if you're not planning to do math, physics, engineering degrees? These quotes come from real students who did further math. So while the universities are asking you to do further math, perhaps just to distinguish between the best candidates, it actually helps you. Even those who come to Swansea, and at Swansea University, it's not a Russell Group University, I hope you would go to a better one, but if you want to come to Swansea, you're welcome. You'll see that further math actually helps. And those the approach that we've done it, you will see it in your undergraduate mathematics course, whether you do engineering, science, technology, or perhaps even economics or finance. You'll see that approach anyway. So for me, further math is not an elitist degree, just more math, and it helps.